Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the Cutting Room in New York City. I'm Brad Talinsky with Backstory Events, and this evening's program is going to be live streamed on guitarworld.com, where it will exist forever and ever, so behave yourself. This is going to be a great evening. A little bit later on, we're going to have Led Zeppelin, the world's premier Led Zeppelin tribute band, come up and play some songs from their really genuinely incredible new EP, The Island of Skyros, which is their orchestral reimagining of a bunch of Led Zeppelin classics. But first, we're going to get the really interesting backstory behind the evolution of this record with the band's leader and guitarist, Steph Paines. I'd like to bring Steph Paines out.
Thank you, Brad.
Good evening.
It's nice to know that something is going to live forever and ever.
Yes, immortal. So, you know, tell us about this project, The Island of Skyros. Like, how did you come up with the idea of working with an orchestra?
Well, about a year ago, we decided to do a show with strings out in Long Island as a sort of one-off, whimsical thing. The promoter was into it, and I was at the Suffolk Theater, and we sort of just decided to commission some charts. We had about five or six, maybe it's about seven of them, and we sort of pulled off this show, and it was so satisfying because, I mean, I get, you know, Led Zeppelin's music is so rich in so many ways, and as the guitar player, we play as a four-piece, the way that Led Zeppelin did. But if you listen to the records, there are 600 guitar parts, or at least four or five, and everything is layered. Jimmy called it his guitar army, and when we had the strings on stage, suddenly the army was present, and it was really a beautiful thing, and people reacted very well. So we decided to keep doing shows like this, and then we got a little more carried away and decided, why not make a record? And here we are.
Well, Zeppelin's music is a little Wagnerian, so we're adding a little bit of Wagner to it, I guess, tonight. Yeah. But why call it The Island of Skyros?
I kind of knew you would ask that. So The Island of Skyros, well, the original working title was Achilles, as some people here know. And it's because Achilles' Last Stand is one of the key numbers on this record. Achilles is just epic. I mean, talk about guitar armies. It is just maybe has the most guitars, and it's just huge composition. So I sort of felt that the record was sort of circling around Achilles' Last Stand. So at first we called it Achilles, and then as time went on, we started to dig a little deeper into this concept of Achilles, being that's what we do sometimes. And as it turns out, if you start to get into the mythology and you start to figure out who Achilles was past his heel, you know, Achilles spent time, his mother, okay, so this is the story. His mother, who was half goddess, had a fortune teller give her a prophecy that Achilles was going to die if he fought in the war against, you know, at Troy, okay? So she didn't want that to happen. So she decided, and Achilles, of course, was the greatest warrior in Greece, everywhere in the world. So she decided to hide him out on the island of Skyros, where he stayed for several years, or in mythological terms. And in order that he wouldn't be discovered, he was disguised as a woman. So, if you put it together, we just thought it was very clever, not clever, yes, it was clever, but it was appropriate to call this the Island of Scyros, which is where Achilles posed as a woman for many years and lived as a woman until, of course, he got dragged out to fight in the war.
Is the record going to come with cliff notes or anything?
That's part of the mystery. Yes, if you haven't read Homer, you can't buy the record.
Well, the record has just come out, or has just been made available, and already there's controversy about it. Can you tell us a little bit about
the controversy?
The controversy.
Yeah, this is exciting, actually. We've already been censored, which is just great news as far as I'm concerned. Apparently, and we could actually take a vote on this, apparently this beautiful record cover, which I think, in my opinion, is quite artistic, and it was done by this amazingly talented graphic designer and artist named Matt Touchard, who lives in New Orleans and has done many record covers. Apparently, CD Baby, we all know who they are, right? They thought this was pornographic and would not accept the record. So, I mean, how many people think this is pornographic? Can we have a show of hands? No? There's no's.
I'm
any
looking.
Yeses? Can you understand why? Well, the lettering covers it a little, but...
I think,
know,
I can see her Skyros from here.
You can see her Skyros, yeah.
No, but not really.
There's a kind of little crack in the Skyros. If you want to put it that way. But really, I mean, in a bit.
That's ridiculous.
Yeah.
If everybody disagrees with CD Baby, let's hear a boo for CD Baby. Come on, boo.
Although that's where you can buy the record now. So we hate them, but we love them. I don't know. In our sort of pussy-grabbing society, I'm not sure why this is particularly offensive. I mean, Donald Trump loved it. We sent it to him.
So, for people that hear the band play later on or just intrigued by this in general, where can they get the Island of Scyros?
Okay, so because it was called the Island of Scyros, unfortunately, they mailed all copies of the vinyl and CDs to the Island of Scyros. No, not really. It would have been a good excuse, though. We do have the record online right now, so this is kind of a premiere announcement, but there will be CDs and there will be vinyl, which we're excited about. And the CDs should be in next week. And vinyl maybe a couple of weeks more, but definitely before Christmas. And right now you can order the CD on CD Baby, the very open-minded CD Baby, or iTunes. It'll be on Amazon and Spotify in the next 24 hours, if sooner. So I encourage you to do that. And if you want to grab vinyl and CDs later, you can do that too, in all those aforementioned places.
So this is an EP, and you have, I think, what is it, 6 or 7 songs on it? How did you choose which songs to give the orchestral treatment to?
Yeah. It's funny, because there are 6 songs on it, but 2 of them are 10 minutes long. So it's actually the same amount of time as Led Zeppelin's 3 and maybe 1. Records were short, and probably every Beatle album. But interestingly, what we discovered when we started to put strings, play with strings, was that there was a lot of room. The arrangements were such that different parts of songs came to light. You know, it was illuminating to sort of have arrangements that you wouldn't necessarily expect. And we decided not to just do them for the softer songs as many would expect us to do, but to really tackle a full-on, the full-on band songs, such as Achilles' Last Stand, which is so epic and thick, you would think, how could you even fit anything into that? But amazingly, the strings, as you'll hear on the record, hopefully, just bring your ear to different parts of the song that you may not have heard before. So we actually picked a display of songs that were not so obvious. An immigrant song, maybe you wouldn't put strings on that. Achilles' Last Stand. And then a couple, you know, Rain song we did do, and some of them which just begged for strings, so.
I mean, my favorite track on it is Battle of Evermore, which just adds so much atmosphere. You guys are gonna do that later on tonight, right?
Yes, we promise.
Cool. Yeah, Rain song might seem like a little redundant, but I've heard you guys perform this before, and somehow it even brought more of an appreciation to John Paul Jones' string arrangements on that. Did you have any reservations about redoing that particular song, because there were strings already?
Yeah, of all of them, I think that was the one that was the most, did we really bother with it? But you're absolutely right. I mean, I think, you know, there's nothing like real strings, if you don't mind me saying it. I mean, it's just, it's a different texture, it's a different depth of sound. And to hear the real strings play those Rain song parts, I mean, it is really beautiful.
Because they were originally all performed on Mellotron, right?
I think so.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
Certainly when we play it live, I mean, yeah, it's everything you usually hear. Right, there is definitely an overwhelming Mellotron. I'm not sure if they actually use strings on it or not, but I don't think so. Mm-hmm. But it's
well, one thing that I thought was really, that I think is really great about the EP and in your performance tonight is that you never really let the strings dominate the arrangements. Like, it doesn't swamp it up. I always say it's not like Cirque du Soleil or something, you know? It's very tasteful, very George Martin.
Take that.
Did you purposefully sort of keep them a little bit minimal? I mean, was that a artistic decision?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, it was, we wanted the full-on band. I know that there are temptations and there are orchestral concerts with Led Zeppelin as done by symphony orchestras and all of this thing. That was not what I had in mind at all. I didn't want to temper it. I didn't want to cut into the ferocity of their music. I didn't want to tame it in any way. And so with that in mind, our arrangements work different parts of the song and somehow fit in with the band full on, not restrained. So it was absolutely intentional.
When you were recording or performing with the strings, do you change anything about the way you perform them in order to accommodate the strings? Or do you sort of make the strings accommodate the band?
We usually have to turn down a little. it's hard to get a full-on band, especially a loud band like Led Zeppelin's, like Led Zeppelin, we're pretty loud, to mix with a string section, because even when you have mics and pickups on the strings, you know, it's hard to compete with a Marshall amp. but we generally have to, it's tricky for our sound engineers. Our sound engineers will attest to that.
So you put it all on the sound engineers.
Yes.
You make them worry
about it. We just let
them
worry about it.
Did you alter the guitar parts? Did you change, or are you sticking pretty close to the original solos and the original performances?
I pretty much play what I usually play, except there are some glorious moments when I try to be five guitars at once and I don't have to. I just can sit and play the rhythm part. There's one song you'll hear tonight, hopefully, Ramble On, that we do, where there's, and everyone always looks over to me and laughs because there's this little middle part with guitars that are harmonized. And for some reason, you know, it never comes out the way I want it to hear, but now I don't have to play it because they're going to play it. And that's really great. So that's, in some sense, I alter it in that way, but not really. I mean, the band is not really altering anything. Yeah. She'll hear.
You know, this will be the first time that some people, especially out in Guitar World land, out in the live stream, that are gonna see you guys play. And I've seen different incarnations of the band, and I think this one is really terrific. And I just thought maybe we could talk about each of the other players. You know, you've been playing like Lisa, the drummer, for a long time now.
Yeah, Lisa Harrington Squires from Texas.
Yes.
She's out there somewhere, drinking coffee, there she is. But Lisa is actually the longest standing member of Led Zeppelin, aside from me. The guitarist remains the same. Lisa joined the band in 2009, and I basically had to hear her play for 30 seconds to know that she's just the best drummer for this ever. But Lisa's from Texas, and she's played everything, and she's John Bonham here.
It's hard to imagine Led Zeppelin without Lisa playing.
Right. That's right. And Led Zeppelin, it's hard to imagine really doing Led Zeppelin without the right kind of drumming. It's really key, and it's very subtle. There's a swing that's really subtle to this music, but it's really important. It's the small things that are super important, and Lisa nails that.
So and Joan, your bass player.
Yes, Joan Chu.
Joan Chu, yeah.
Joan Chu, again, in the corner.
I mean, Joan really does function almost as John Paul Jones in this band because I saw her working with the string section.
Yeah,
earlier.
She might even play more instruments than John Paul Jones. I'm not sure, but she plays violin. I'm not sure John Paul Jones played the violin. And she plays mandolin, and she plays keyboards, and she plays bass, and you know, and the guitar when I force her to. And Joan is, you know, absolutely irreplaceable, really. She's just can play everything, and she can lead the string section. And Joan actually worked on the arrangements for this record, and she did a few of her own, and she adapted some that we already had. So it's just wonderful. So she can lead. She could have been in the string section, except we need her for the bass. So
yeah, you'll see when they perform. She's making the nods over to the string section. They're dancing to Joan's tune.
She's gesticulating.
and Marlene sort of she's a relatively new addition to the band, but
right.
She has a very interesting backstory.
Yes, she does. Marlene is back there too. The backstory. Marlene Angelidis, which she's actually from Cyprus, so you know, Island of Skyros. This album is kind of focused on her. but Marlene's an amazing singer. She's also an actress and a voiceover artist. She's multi-talented as well. Everyone in this band really is. It's beautiful. But Marlene has done all sorts of types of music. She studied at the Royal Academy of Arts in London, and has math and science degrees and all the rest of it. And she, I won't tell you the name of her old band because she'll kill me later, but she's been in bands that are quite different than this, yet all girls, and were very popular. So she really, she can handle anything, and the way she's approached doing Robert Plant is from a really artistic point of view, you know, understanding that she doesn't have to impersonate him, but somehow capturing his zeitgeist, which is key. You know, that's kind of what we do. Rather, we don't impersonate. We try to capture the sort of
the
fairy
vibe.
Dust.
The vibe.
The vibe, yeah. very 70s, Brad, the vibe.
Yes, exactly. The vibe is important. I can feel it in this room. So you guys are performing the entirety of Physical Graffiti. And I think, are you taking that on the road? You're doing that? What was it like to learn all of that music?
Wow. So that, yes. Physical Graffiti, I mean, a lot. Is it some people's favorite album? Many? Yeah, lots. I see hands. It's one of my favorite albums. It might be my favorite album. There's more of it, first of all. There are two albums. And really, since I started this band, it's been my dream to play Physical Graffiti. It just seems like the top of the mountain for some reason.
It's your Everest.
It's my Everest. And it's because there are so many different styles on Physical Graffiti. It's formidable. In a way, I think it captures all of what Led Zeppelin were in a certain sort of way. It's got hard rockers, it's got bluesy numbers, it's got the folk, Celtic folk stuff. It's, you know, it really covers the spectrum, which is why it's hard to play. But there are also some songs that are almost impossible to play live with four people. I mean, you would need, you know, three keyboards and five guitars and all that, but we've figured it out. So we're going to do it.
So what was the most challenging for you?
In the Light. Yeah. In the Light is the one. And it also happened, it might be my, people ask me what my favorite Led Zeppelin song is. Impossible to say, but that's one of them. I just love the whole mystical aspect of it and the way that it crashes into this heavy, you know, verse. But it's really hard to do because there's a drone and there are many keyboards and there are harmonized guitars. And to do it with four people is you need a bunch of keyboards. I'm stepping on things. Joan is being an octopus. It's, you know, but we sorted it out and we're excited.
So it's a little bit more common these days to have, you know, women playing, you know, men, you know, male bands like, you know, and
you can say it,
bands.
Use the C word.
Yes, but you guys really, you were really pioneering this. I was wondering, what made you think that Led Zeppelin would be, you know, sort of androgynous and be able to adapt to a woman's point of view?
You know,
the first two records are pretty macho, you know?
Yeah, and when we first started, that was the sort of thing that fascinated everybody. Why were women, four women, playing this music that was so male? I mean, it was just like, guy music. The fans were guys, and it somehow the lyrics were all about, you know, guys, you know, doing it to girls.
Squeezing stuff.
Squeezing and cracks and stuff like that, you know. So. Yeah, see? Right. It's got that. I didn't think about that. I mean, that's just sort of, that was one thing I didn't really think that it should in any way inhibit me playing the music that I really loved. And I really loved Led Zeppelin, and I really wanted to play it. And as a guitar player, it seemed like the most amazing way to study guitar, which it is. And I just forged ahead. But it was so interesting that people were wondering how we could do this, and they all thought it was gimmicky. I mean, to me, it wasn't. But I began to realize, soon after starting the band, that it was a lot deeper than just the playing of the music, because the idea of four women coming out and assuming the attitude of a band like Led Zeppelin, and that's everything from the sexualness of the guitar playing and the singing, which was androgynous, but it was very sort of sexual, and coming out empowered like that, nobody'd really seen that. I mean, I would argue you don't really even see it that much right now. Four women playing this kind of music that's so intense, that's so beautifully complex, with the kind of bravado that you need to play this music. And I think it shocked people. Sometimes it still does, although we're more used to it now. But
it inspired a lot of people, too.
Yeah, I hope so.
Yeah. So Jimmy Page once saw you guys play. What was that like?
The scariest gig I ever did in my life. It would have been enough to know Jimmy was in the room while I was having a drink, but that I had to stand on stage and play his parts, knowing that he would be in the audience, and it was a long time coming. I mean, you know, I should say that I take this very seriously, and to me, I'm always playing thinking that Jimmy's in the room somewhere. Like, that's my bar. I have to have that kind of bar. So I told myself before this gig, it was in London, where he came to see us, and we kind of knew he would come because he said he might, and to put him on the guest list. So
did he ask for a plus one?
Yes. He had a plus one.
Okay.
And he walked into the room. It was packed in the middle, you know, in the middle of, I think, my bow solo, which of all things to walk in. We were in the middle of Dazed and Confused, and all I know is later everyone said, don't tell Steph, you know, he's here. But it was an amazing thing. You know, I just told myself, I play as if he's here every night. The fact that he's here, so what? It worked partially. But we just decided we're just going to give it everything we got, which we usually try to do, or we do, whether we like it or not. And he loved it, thankfully, because that, to me, that was the ultimate affirmation. You know, if Jimmy had not liked it, I'm not sure what I would have done. Maybe I moved to Morocco or something, moved to the island of Skyros. But he loved it, and he loved it, I think, you know, we charged backstage and just spent at least an hour or more with us. I think he loved it because we were not impersonating. What we were capturing is what he, and I'm speaking for him, I'm sorry, but I think he would agree. We were capturing the spirit and the intensity and the intentionality of this music and playing it with everything we had and not playing every single note. They wouldn't have played every single note. And I think he was shocked that we got that, and he loved it for that. It was great.
Yeah, I mean, as a person that's a big fan of Led Zeppelin, I wrote a book on them, et cetera, et cetera.
On Jimmy.
I've seen a lot of these bands, and most of them do leave me cold. And I think that that's really what makes you guys great, is you take chances and you take liberties and it's more about capturing the spirit rather than, oh my God, I've got to get this note this way or that way. So I hope all of you, when the band comes out and plays, sees that and appreciates that. So there are a bunch of liberties that you can take with Led Zeppelin's music, but as a guitarist, what actually has to be there in order to be Led Zeppelin?
Right, I think you have to really learn the parts and really learn it in a strict sort of way, at least first. And then I think it's a matter of taste. And this is where it gets tricky, but I think you just have to know intuitively what guitar parts need to stay the same. You know, the solo in the ocean, you probably have to play these beautiful things that were written or that you hear, just because you're really not going to do any better than that. But in songs like I Can't Quit You, or in songs that are blues, or in big solo cadenza songs like Dazed and Confused, where you have a bow solo, I think once you get your head around it, and once you can speak the language, like Jimmy's language as a guitar player, I mean, that's sort of what took me years to really get into, but I know it so well that it's become part of my language. So I wouldn't play a Jimi Hendrix solo over this blues solo. I would hope that I were sort of using his vocabulary, musical vocabulary, to create something on the spot. And usually it's during those kinds of numbers, like you know, the blues numbers or Dazed, which the bow solo is all mine for the most part. And sometimes it's better than others, but that's part of it. That's, I mean, I believe in that, you know, so.
Now I know what songs you like to play, but I also know a song that you don't like to play.
Yes, I know. I know where you're going with this.
Steph always says, do we really have to play Stairway to Heaven? So I was sort of wondering, why is Stairway to Heaven a pain in the ass for you?
Stairway denied, sorry. Partially because of that, because everyone plays it. Stairway, you know, I always like to say it's a bit like Hamlet's soliloquy, you know, it's a stairway that just goes on and on and on. So to get it right is tricky, for one. Because the song, it's not that it's technically hard to play. Like, really, once you're at this level of playing Led Zeppelin fluently, it's not technical anymore. You know, I think that's important. That's the only way to let go, is if it's not technically challenging. You can't do that if you're staring at your hands, right? So it's not that. It's just that the arc of Stairway is so perfect on the record, and there are also so many parts to it that it's kind of hard to, you know, get that right. Yeah. And also, you can't make a mistake. Like, if I make a mistake with a little beginning or something, forget about it. I'm sorry. Everyone will know. Everyone. So it's scary, too.
I also think it's a magic recording.
Yes, it is.
And so that's really difficult to beat when you're playing live. You know, everybody knows every note and every reverb and every sound. And it is a magic recording. So to play that live is really
sort daunting.
Of daunting, yeah. So anyways, I'm really, really excited to hear the band play. I mean, I heard them play with the strings in rehearsal and at one other performance, and it just really knocked me out. The Island of Skyros, you can order it on iTunes or CD Baby. You know, after you hear them play, you'll immediately want to go and push the computer button or something, get it for yourself. And I'd like to thank Steph for coming out here and Led Zeppelin
thank
to perform.
You.
And we're going to take...
It's an honor and a pleasure.
We're going to take a little bit of a break, and then we're going to come back and the band's going to play. Everybody, Steph Paynes. Yeah.
Yes. And Mr. Brad Talinsky, please.
You got your fiddles, everything's all good. Okay, everybody. You ready to hear some Led Zeppelin with a whole lot of strings?
Yeah!
Come on, let's hear it. Okay, let's bring on the band. Joan, Steph, Marlene, and Lisa. One, two.
Yeah. Ears, please. Thank you.
Nice we get to talk to more people now on stage.
Hello, everybody. Thank you for coming out.
Of light took her bow and then she turned to go. The Prince of Peace embraced the gloom and walked the night alone.
Oh, dance in the dark and I love, sing to the moon.
The Dark Lord rides in force tonight, time will tell us all. Side by side, we wait the might, the darkest of them all. I hear the horses thunder. Babylon, waiting for the eastern glow.
So who's coming to the Gramercy Theatre?
Yes, ma'am.
I hear you. Physical Graffiti, December 7th, everybody. Thank you so much. So everybody, I would like to introduce you to everybody here on stage, and this time we have more people. So, and we thank you very much, guys, for joining us and for making this a very special evening. Jennifer DeVore on cello. Earl Manian on viola. Joe Denonzone on violin. and Michael Paines on violin as well. Just in case you guys didn't know who the people are, Lisa Harrington Squires on the drums. Miss Joan Chu on bass.
I think they know who I am, but it's fine. It's fine. It's fine. And please, on vocals, Miss Marlene Angelides, please. Okay, I'm Steph Paines. I'm related to Michael Paines. I'm his sister. I'm very honored to be his sister.
I'm gonna leave you. I said, baby, you know I'm gonna leave you. I'll leave you in the summertime, leave you in the summer comes a rolling. Leave you when the summer comes along.
But I gotta get away from this place. I've gotta quit you, yeah.
When it's calling me back are falling all around. Time I was on my way. Thanks to you, I'm much obliged for such a pleasant stay. But now it's time for me to go. The autumn moon lights my way. And with it pain, and it's headed my way. Mm-hmm. sometimes I grow so tired. But I know I've got one thing I gotta do. Ramble on. And now's the time, the time is now to sing my song. I go around the world, I gotta find my girl. On my way. I've been this way 10 years to the day. I gotta ramble on. I gotta find the queen of all my dreams. Got no time for spreading roots. The time has come to be gone. And though our health we drank 1,000 times, it's time to ravel on. Can't be told. My freedom I hold dear. How years ago in days of old, where magic filled the air. 'Twas in the darkest depths of mortar I met a girl so fair. The evil one crept up and slipped away with her. Her, yeah. Ain't nothing I can do, no. I guess I gotta keep on reveling. I'm gonna, yeah, yeah, yeah. I gotta find my baby. I gotta revel.
Single. Oh yeah, thank you.
Yes, this next song has actually already been released. Who's heard? Well, we don't know. You don't know which one it's going to be, do you? Who's heard Immigrant Song already online with the strings? Has anybody heard it? Okay, we have a few hands. Well, enjoy.
Drive our ships to fuel.
to fight the hordes, singing and crying, Valhalla I am coming.
Now we're sweeping, thrashing on, our only goal will be the Western Shore.
Soft you feel so green with the tales of gore, of how we caught the tides of war.
CD Baby. Thank you so much for coming out this evening.